Fatigue is the most common symptom in MS. It's the leading cause of loss of work in MS, and it's one of the most poorly understood symptoms. In this video, I'm going to share with you 50 contributors to fatigue and how we can make it better. Don't turn away, because that starts right now. My name is Aaron Boster, and thank you for learning about MS with me. I am the founder of the Boster Center for Multiple Sclerosis, where we accept all major insurance carriers and we see people from around the globe, both in the office and on telemedicine. So if you would like a consult, call the number below. Today's discussion is on fatigue. MS fatigue is poorly understood. It's an invisible symptom because,
honey, you look so good.
And yet it's the leading cause of loss of work and one of the major causes of loss of quality of life in the setting of multiple sclerosis. It's super hard to study. It's even hard to define. And in this video, I want to share with you 50 different contributors to fatigue. In essence, many different aspects of an individual's life with MS can cause them to become tired. And if we can start to unravel those causes, we can start to treat some of them and actually make your fatigue better. So let's jump in. Number one is undertreated MS. If your disease-modifying therapy is not holding your disease at bay, or if you're not on a disease-modifying therapy, then quite bluntly, I expect you to be fatigued. Conversely, when we get you on a highly effective disease-modifying therapy, oftentimes what I see is an amelioration of energy levels. People have more energy and they have less fatigue when we properly slow the inflammation driving their MS disease. Limb weakness. If your left leg is weak and you're ambulating, you are putting forth a tremendous amount of effort to drive that leg forward to make yourself walk, and that can make you tired. Similarly, motor fatigue is a phenomenon where people start off strong, but after they ambulate a while, after they walk for a bit, their legs become weak and they have to rest. Spasticity, I talk a lot about on this channel, and it's where your muscles are literally fighting each other. So when you try to extend your leg out, it's also trying to pull itself back, and you're in a tug of war with your own limb, and that can make you exhausted. Also, physical inactivity. If you're kind of a couch potato, you will find that you have much less energy than if you exercise. It is critically important that people with MS embrace exercise in some form as part of their lifestyle because it combats everything I just said. And if you're having trouble coming up with a way to exercise, talk to your MS doc and find out if there's a form of aquatic therapy or a form of chair yoga or something that might fit the bill for you. I also have to share that being obese contributes to fatigue. So if you're overweight, it's something to work on. Shedding pounds will help give you back energy. Neuropathic pain is another one of those fantastically invisible symptoms where it feels like your leg is burning or your arm is on fire or that your torso is being crushed, and yet,
honey, you look so good.
What people oftentimes don't realize is that hurting chronically, chronic neuropathic pain, saps our energy and it can make us exhausted. And treating the neuropathic pain many times actually improves energy levels. People impacted by MS are twice as likely, as compared to the general population, to experience depression and anxiety. And both of those are well known to contribute to fatigue. If your mood is not right, and we treat it, you'll find that your energy levels go up, which is awesome. Social isolation is all too common amongst people impacted by MS. And social isolation can contribute to a lot of bad things, like worsening depression and worsening fatigue. Believe it or not, planning a social outing, getting out of your shell, and interacting with others still helps combat social isolation and in turn can help with energy levels. Try it out. Pseudobulbar affect is an unusual symptom where someone impacted by MS may start crying except they don't feel sad, or they may start laughing hysterically and they don't feel happy. And people impacted by pseudobulbar affect will oftentimes tell me that those outward expressions of emotions, those affects, the crying spells and laughing spells are exhausting. Fortunately, pseudobulbar affect is treatable. And when we treat it, we not just help with that disconnect of emotion and affect, we also help with energy. To state the obvious, insomnia worsens fatigue. Many people impacted by MS experience insomnia for a myriad of reasons. And if you can work with your doctor to pick apart the insomnia and improve the quality of your sleep, the length of your sleep, to get to bed and really get some good rest, you're going to find that you have so much more energy. This is an important one. It stands to reason that someone who has shift work syndrome is going to be tired. If you work third shift and the whole world is on first shift time, you're going to be out of sync with everyone. And what that means is when you're trying to sleep, everyone else is up. And it's loud outside and the TV might be on and your family members might be walking around and you're going to be getting phone calls and it's disruptive to your sleep patterns. Now, some people don't have a choice and they have to work second or third shift, but those people have to take extra special precautions to secure their room, to make sure it's dark, to make sure that they carve out time to sleep, that they put their phone on silent. There's a lot of work that goes into getting restorative sleep and having adequate energy when you're a second or third shifter. To that end, make sure that you're scheduling enough hours of sleep. If you're only getting 4, 5, 6 hours of sleep, that's literally not enough. And you can help your energy levels just by docking some more hours in the bed with snooze time. Try it out. Now, of course, there are a host of sleep disorders which can also contribute to not getting restful, good night's sleep and make you exhausted the next day. These aren't caused by MS, but they're more common in the setting of MS. Things like obstructive sleep apnea, where the tissue of the throat kind of closes when you sleep and results in snoring and oftentimes results in waking you up from sleep, sleep apnea. If you wake up with a headache, or if you wake up and you don't feel refreshed upon waking, I'm concerned you might have sleep apnea, and I want you to talk to your doctor about it. Similarly, if you have restless leg syndrome, a compulsion to shake your legs and it interrupts your ability to fall asleep, or if you have nocturia, that's a doctor word for man, I get up to pee all night long. These are things that are terribly disruptive. Neuropathic pain, pain in your legs or anywhere else in your body that keeps you awake, or spasms and cramps, spasticity at night, are notorious for interrupting sleep. If you have these things, get ye to your doctor's office, talk to your clinician, and let's try to work on making them better. Of course, sometimes when we try to make things better in medicine, we apply medications, and medications have side effects. And many of the medicines that are used to treat symptoms in MS can cause fatigue. So that doesn't mean that they're no-nos and we should never use them, but it does mean that we need to be aware of that and we need to think about if these medicines might be contributing to our decreased energy levels. Things like the use of tricyclic antidepressants, so medicines like Pamelor or Elavil, are notorious for causing sedation. Some of the bladder medicines that we use, some of the pain medicines we use, both narcotic medicines, but also neuropathic pain medicines, like ones that were invented for certain forms of depression or seizures that are used to treat neuropathic pain, they can make you tired. Seizure medicines themselves can oftentimes cause fatigue. So can allergy medicines. So can benzodiazepines like Valium and Xanax and medicines like that. And of course, narcotics. So think about it. If you're on these medicines and you're struggling with fatigue, maybe it's time to talk to your clinician about whether you can decrease them or switch them out for something else. It's worth asking. There are a host of recreational drugs that people sometimes use that can contribute to fatigue. Things like alcohol. Alcohol is a sedative hypnotic, and it can contribute to making you more tired. Marijuana, cannabis, has a side effect of fatigue. If you're taking a stimulant medicine and then you come off of it, you can go through a withdrawal. And the stimulant withdrawal oftentimes involves a fatigue syndrome. Same thing with cocaine. Withdrawing from cocaine can cause fatigue. Now, whereas many viewers might not be struggling with cocaine and amphetamine withdrawal, you may be dealing with fast food, sugar, and caffeine. All of these actually can contribute to fatigue. Very often we can get into a cycle with caffeine where we use too much during the day and then it keeps us awake at night. Excessive sugar, in my strong opinion, is a driver of fatigue. And I can't tell you how many times in clinic we've gotten someone to step away from sugary foods or to excessive sugar in their diet and their energy goes up. If you haven't experienced that, I double dog dare you to try it because it works. Similarly, avoiding fast foods, processed foods, fried foods, if you can avoid those kind of foods, you'll find that your energy levels improve. I dare you to replace soda pop with water and see what happens to your energy levels. It's kind of awesome. Speaking of water, if you're dehydrated, you'll notice that you have less energy. Making sure that you have adequate water through the day is a pro tip to actually improve fatigue. And there are a lot of nutritional things that we want to consider beyond that. Thyroid abnormalities, B12 deficiency, vitamin D deficiency, poor caloric intake, just not feeding the engine. And in men, low testosterone have all been shown to contribute to fatigue in the setting of MS. As my late mentor used to say, sometimes nature can be too generous, and you can have MS and something else, and both can contribute to fatigue. If you have uncontrolled diabetes, you're going to be more tired. If you frequently have migraine headaches, or if you have seizures, you're going to be dealing with the aftermath of both of those, which can cause fatigue. If you have frequent urinary tract infections or other infections, this can include something like a tooth infection, decubitus ulcers, or bed sores. These are great generators of fatigue. And when you treat the infections, the energy levels improve. My point here is fatigue is a monster in MS. And I just finished listing almost 50 different contributors. If any of these resonate with you, if you have any of those things I've listed, that may be making your energy levels worse. And I challenge you to talk to your clinician about trying to improve it. My name's Aaron Boster, and again, I want to thank you for learning about MS with me. So until my next live stream, or my next YouTube video, or the next time I see you at the Boster Center for MS, be healthy, be safe, and take care.